Well, shalom, shalom, Israel. I am Rebekah Kahav at Yahuwah from Teshuvah Ministries again. And today, this is video number 4 in my little mini-series about should Christians keep the feasts or not. So again, this is in response to an email I got from a Christian man who had some statements and questions, statements that I'm addressing and questions that I'm trying to answer. So today, in this short little video, I hope it's short, we are going to answer the question, why can't we just incorporate feast keeping into our Christian beliefs? So this was a question again posed by Harry, a man I am calling Harry, who sent me the email. He said, why can't we just incorporate feast keeping into our Christian beliefs? Well, I do have an answer for this one, for sure. Okay, so I know that it is super hard to entertain the idea that your entire life's devotion to a sect of Christianity and its traditions is being called into question here. I recognize that this is hard, but I am not here to coddle you, to itch your ears or tell you what you want to hear. So something that you probably do not want to hear is that you cannot stay a Christian and keep the biblical feasts. All right, that would be mixture. Well, actually, more than mixture, that would be basically impossible. And here's why. Let me explain. Let's take, for instance, Hanukkah and Christmas. All right, Hanukkah is a biblical feast. It was recorded in the Apocrypha. It is definitely not one of the 7 high Shabbats commanded by Yehovah in his covenant, but it was given to Israel later on after a defeat of pagan idolatry in the temple. Hanukkah is celebrated during the winter. And let's take Christmas, for instance. In comparison, Christmas falls about the very same time, and it is steeped and rooted in the worship of a pagan deity. So Christmas is the high holy day of Christendom, all right? And this holiday was adopted by idolatrous Israel from pagan sun god worship. It's paganism. It's nothing new. It's just repackaged a little differently to be a little more palatable to modern humans. This is what Israel has done for most of its existence. It has adopted pagan garbage. Now, if you want to learn more about Christmas and its roots and where it came from, please go see Jim Staley's Truth or Tradition. Michael Rood also has some good stuff on that, as well as many other teachers out there. This is nothing new. This is not a silent thing. It is so getting out there in our face right now, and you're really being challenged to make a clear distinction between, am I going to celebrate this festival or am I not? And because it's really coming out in the open right now. But here, for the point of this video, we're looking at the contrast between this pagan winter festival that Christians celebrate and have adopted, and Hanukkah, which is totally in line with the scriptures. And it's actually in our canon up until, 150 years ago or so. And did you know, again, Christmas was actually illegal in this country 150 years ago. Something like that. You could actually be thrown in jail for having a tree up because the early settlers knew what this holiday was about and they knew where it was from. It's a repackaged Saturnalia, basically. So let's look at the true Hanukkah. The true Hanukkah is a celebration of freedom from pagan sun god worship. All right, the Maccabees went into the temple and they cleansed it from that pagan crap that Antiochus Epiphanes, who wanted to be God on earth, had set up in Yah's temple. And so the Maccabees cleaned it up and they rededicated it to be about its original purpose, was to be a home and a house for Elohim, Yahuwah Elohim. It was not to be a house for sun god worship. So they cleansed it and rededicated it, okay? That's the true Hanukkah. Now, if you need to know more about the true Hanukkah and you don't know what the true Hanukkah is and you think it's a mixture of, you know, like, a, I don't know, Christmas and Hanukkah together, that is not what the true Hanukkah is about. So definitely go watch. I think I'll try to put a link up here, or a little card, so you can go watch my video teaching about Hanukkah. So if you look at the two festivals here side by side, you have Christmas, which is a pagan sun god. It's participation in pagan sun god worship, and you have Hanukkah. Hanukkah is a celebration of freedom from pagan sun god worship. All right. So again, Hanukkah is the celebration of when Judah Maccabee and his warriors cleansed the temple from pagan sun god worship. and rededicated it to its original purpose. So here we see pagan sun god worship at the heart of Christmas, and we see Hanukkah, a celebration of freedom from that worship. Okay, do you see how they can't be in the same building? They can't be in the same room together? Hanukkah is a celebration of freedom from pagan sun god worship, okay? So you can't do both in Hanukkah. It is absolutely impossible. One is dedication to the original design to be a house for Yehovah, and the other honors pagan sun gods. And you're going to become a house for a pagan deity. Now, before I go on, I know that a lot of Christians are going to really resist this and say, oh, but that's not what it means to me. In fact, I wonder if Harry is saying that right now, if he's watching. He's probably saying, well, that's not what Christmas means to me. It's all about the birth of Jesus. Well, actually, no, it's not about the birth of Jesus. It is, Jesus wasn't even, Jesus, who his name is actually not Jesus, his name is Yeshua. He was actually born during the Feast of Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles, when Elohim came and tabernacled among us. Hello, don't you know your scriptures? So anyway, do your research on Christmas and you'll find out the roots of it are completely pagan, and there is no way to clean and to cleanse something that started out as evil, all right? But Hanukkah started out as good. It's a beautiful festival, and that is true. So this also is the same for Easter. This is the second high holy day of Christendom. So if you are a Christian, you are celebrating Christmas and Easter, correct? Right. Okay, stay with me. So Easter originated as a pagan festival. Ishtar is the goddess of fertility, love, storms, war, and is arguably the most important mother goddess in Mesopotamia. She bears the title Queen of Heaven. This is the pagan deity that the scripture says that Israel was worshiping and that Yah was super angry with the fact that they were worshiping her. So if you don't know the history of where Easter comes from, please go dig into some research and find out. I know that Michael Rood has a bunch out there, Jim Staley also. There are so many teachers that have a ton of stuff about where this evil holiday comes from, and that has been adopted by rebellious Israel and adopted as if Yehovah wants to be worshiped in this way, as if it's Passover. It is not anything about Passover. Let's look in Jeremiah 7:18. The children gather wood, the fathers light the fire, and the women knead the dough and make cakes of bread for the Queen of Heaven. They pour out drink offerings to other gods to provoke me to anger. All right, so they are making things to celebrate this Queen of Heaven. Do we not do that for the God of Christmas and the God of Easter? Yes, it's just repackaged paganism, people. That's all it is. So Easter was originally the celebration of Ishtar, the Assyrian and Babylon goddess of fertility and sex. As I said before, her symbols, the egg and the bunny, were and still are fertility and sex symbols. Where do you think the eggs and the bunnies came from? Do you think they had anything or have anything to do with the resurrection? Absolutely not. They are steeped in idolatry. Ishtar or Easter has absolutely nothing to do with Passover. And Passover is the true holy day at that same time of year. So as you can tell, you've got the true holiday at both these times of year, and then you have a counterfeit holiday, right? And so what did Yehovah says? He said he would send a great deception. We're talking end of the age, great deception, but throughout the entire scriptures, you see different points in time where it's either Yehovah sending a deception or it's Hasatan sending a deception to see what we want, to give us a clear choice. And so I'm here to give you some information so that you can make a clear decision on, do you want to celebrate pagan festivals or do you want to celebrate something that is holy, something that's created by Yehovah, not devised by the one who comes to us from the pit of hell to confuse us and to bring chaos and give us another option besides the true stuff. Yeah. So back to Harry's question, why can't we just, as Christians, just keep the biblical feast, stay a Christian and keep the feast? As I'm trying to make clear here, to be a Christian, one needs to celebrate Christendom's holy days, okay? When you want to be a Christian, you have to adopt the things that a Christian looks like, right? And those holy days for a Christian are primarily Easter and Christmas, or and some others, but basically those two. Do you see that by definition, if you don't celebrate those holy days, then you cannot be a Christian, then you're not a Christian. If you embrace Yehovah's holy days, his feasts, his moedim, his appointments, then you are not a Christian, you're a Hebrew. You've crossed over from pagan sun god worship to the God of, to obey the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Do you understand? Do you catch me there? I'm trying to make the point that Christendom has its holidays, and all Christians celebrate them. Okay, you can't be a Christian and not celebrate Christ's birth on December 25th. You'd be ostracized, as I was. You would be kicked out of your family, as I was. You know, you would lose most of your friends and family, as we have, you know. I mean, when you cross over, you cross over, and you repent, and you turn towards the God of the Bible, and this is one of the hugest ways you're going to do that. A lot of people right now call themselves Messianic. I choose to call ourselves basically a Brit Torah observant, so the covenant law observant. Call ourselves Hebrews who believe in Yeshua the Messiah because we have crossed over. I call ourselves Melchizedek priests. But a lot of people identify as Messianic or Hebrew roots, that sort of thing. And they're all in this process of doing that Teshuvah, doing that turn. And in the process, they're losing a ton of their family, a ton of their friends and everything because they're giving up these two high holy days and especially Christmas. Especially Christmas. You know, you could get away with it as a new Hebrew. You can get away with it for maybe a year or two. Your family will be understanding about it, but give it a few more and your family's gonna be down your throat why you're not sitting at that Christmas table and participating in that festival with them. And in no way will they come over to celebrate your holidays, the Yehovah's holidays with you. They don't want anything to do with that. So which one are you? Yeah. Are you trying to get your family to continue celebrating the pagan festivals? As the patriarch of your family, are you trying to help promote pagan rituals? Are you persecuting your children, your family members, for trying to teshuvah, trying to turn back to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and obey him? Are you persecuting them? Really think through this. Really take an audit of what you're doing and why you're doing it. And if you are rebellious at heart and you will have nothing to do with turning to obey and teshuving, then you will be lost. You will be lost. I am 100% sure that if you have children or a spouse or parents who are doing this teshuva and they have invited you over into celebrating the feast with them instead of meeting at your Christmas table, come meet at Yah's table. I know 100% that how much their heart would rejoice for you to do that turn. But remember, you can't come over to these festivals and feasts of Yehovah and then go back to your pagan ones. That doesn't work. Can't do that. You would be in severe trouble then. You're in severe trouble now if you know the truth and you don't move on it. But you would be in big trouble, big hot water with Papa. There would be absolutely, like if we saw in the verse in the last video, there would be absolutely no hope for you for change. There'd be no more, there's no more sacrifice for that sin. It is sin and it's going to take you down. You are going to pay for your iniquities. And that is one of them. To celebrate pagan stuff and not come over to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and serve him. So Yehovah says in Deuteronomy 12, 30-31, take heed to yourself that you are not ensnared to follow them. And he's talking about the nations. He's talking about the heathens after they are destroyed from before you and that you do not inquire after their gods saying, how did these nations serve their gods? I will do likewise. You shall not worship Yehovah your Elohim in that way, for every abomination to Yehovah which he hates they have done to their gods, for they even burn their sons and daughters in the fire to their gods. I am just going to, just for a second, and I know this is kind of going down a rabbit trail here, but you're probably saying to me, if you're a Christian and you're watching this and you're not on board yet with this repentance thing, you're probably saying, well, I don't burn my children in the fire anymore. I don't carve, you know, idols with of wood and stone and bow down to them. Oh, really? Oh, really? So let's look at Christmas for a second. There's such a thing as called Santa Claus, right? And I mean, just look at the history of all that. It's so disgusting. It makes your stomach sick. I fall down on my face all the time. Every single year, almost just in unbelief, sorrow that I ever touched that festival. But you take your baby and you go to the mall. And there's Santa there, some drunk from the street that looks like Santa. And they dressed him up. And you hand your screaming baby over to this pot-bellied red guy in a red suit, and your baby's screaming, and you're doing that in trade for what? So they can ask Santa for something? That's in trade for life, right? Well, just go back 1,000 years. You have this big god Chemish, big pot-bellied stone god. They burn it, get it really hot, so it's fiery red. Take their screaming babies and put them in the fire in trade for what? In trade for good crops next year. It's the same damn thing. It's the same damn thing. It's just repackaged so that you, modern human, will do it. Hasatan's goal is to get you to separate yourself from Yehovah and from the life-saving covenant that's going to save your behind someday. But you and your hard hearts continue to propagate this pagan festival from, you know, it's all year long. It's in every hall. It's in every movie. It's, you know, you have Christmas in July. You have this garbage. It's nonsense. It's everywhere. Right now, it's in the stores already. And this is like, what, it was just, I saw it in the stores at the end of June. I'm blown away at the dumbness and the idiocy of everyone. I mean, can't you open your eyes and see what the problem is here? The problem is idolatry, and that hasn't changed. And all Hasatan did was just repackage it just a little bit in the 50s or something, 30s, 40s, 50s, somewhere in there. He repackaged it with this cute Santa with a Coca-Cola bottle. I'm just saying, if you are a patriarch of your family and you continue to promote this horrible pagan festival, and you persecute your children for not showing up to your feast table, you are in deep trouble with Yehovah. And I hope you hear me, and you hear me good. And if Harry's listening to me, I hope Harry hears me as well. Okay, let's go on. Yeshua quotes his father's words from Isaiah 29:13 and Matthew 15:9. He restates, "In vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." All right, Saturnalia, aka Christmas, commandment of men, not his. If you are a Christian and you want to believe in a risen Messiah, why the hell would you celebrate a festival from the pit of hell and ignore the biblical feast as if they were bad? Like, you get hives when you think about celebrating Hanukkah or the biblical feast days, but take away your precious Christmas and you come out with like lashing and teeth grinding and such an unrepentant heart and stiff-necked. Oh, Israel, get a grip and return to your Yehovah. Turn to your Elohim and beg for forgiveness. He will give it. He wants to forgive you, and he wants to cleanse you in the blood of his son, in his perfect blood, and he wants to put you on the path to serving him only and offering worship and service to only him. And to rededicate your temple to what it's originally created for, which is to be a house for him, not a house for a pagan deity. All right, let's keep going. So, Christmas observance is a tradition of men, and the commandments of Yehovah forbid it. Okay, Yeshua said further in Mark 7:9, "You neatly set aside the commandment of Yehovah to maintain your own tradition." How much more clear can you get? The commandment of men to keep Christmas. Do you ever see anywhere in what Yeshua said where he said you must keep Christmas? No! He wasn't even born on that day. He was born during Sukkot. "You neatly set aside the commandment of Yehovah to maintain your own tradition." This is your own tradition. And you are going to kneel down at that tree and serve that tree over kneeling down and serving Yehovah. I do not want to be anywhere near you when the lightning strikes. The feasts are the holy days of Yah for his people, Israel. The pagan festivals are the holy days of the Mithra worshiper Constantine for Christians and pagans. The holy days of Christianity contradict the biblical feasts. Okay? Let me say that again. The holy days of Christianity contradict the biblical feast. Just like I said, you cannot celebrate both Christmas and the true Hanukkah. You can't do it at the same time. You can't celebrate Easter and Passover because, as the scripture says, check this out, one cannot eat at Yah's table and the tables of demons at the same time. So 1 Corinthians 10:21 says you cannot drink the cup of Yahovah and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both Yah's table and the table of demons. So do you see? That wasn't my words. I'm restating what the scripture says. The scripture says you cannot drink from Yah's table and the table of demons. Therefore, you cannot take part in Yah's feasts and the feasts of demons. Okay, so again, feast keeping does not mix with Christian beliefs because the feasts reveal the error in many of the Christian beliefs. So they are completely incompatible. So no, you cannot be a Christian and celebrate the feast. It doesn't work. Plus, the feasts are commanded by Yah, and the man-made religion of Christianity does not require its followers to keep Yah's law. Bingo! Christians might study the feasts and then celebrate one as purely like a novel thing or as an educational experience. I know many people that do this. They may glean some truth, but in order to actually keep the feast, a Christian would have to repent from the pagan holidays and actually do the true ones. Year after year after year, year after year after year, do the true ones until you hit the dirt, people, or until he comes to get you. When he comes the second time. In that action, if you did repent and you did give up your pagan celebrations of Christmas and Easter and you turned and you never touched those again and you turned and you celebrated Hanukkah and Passover and all the other beautiful festivals and feasts of Yahuwah, if you did that, then you would no longer be a Christian. You would be a Hebrew. I'm trying to clear this up. I hope I'm doing an okay job of it, but please let me know in the comments below. No, actually, don't let me know in the comments below. You'll tear me apart, and I have no intent. I have no desire to hear. Yeah, only tell me if you hear what I'm saying, okay? So I know quite a few Christians who like to come to our feast tables or to the feast tables that we host for Yahuwah, but I truly don't really want to pursue them. I found out over the years that they just like to come to get a little bit of education, but they really don't want to repent. And so they leave our feast table, Yah's feast table, and they go, you know, straight over into their own pagan stuff. And it is heartbreaking. So celebrating the feasts is a form of worship. It's worshiping Yahuwah as he commanded. And the holidays of Christianity are an attempt for Christians to worship him in a way that he specifically said not to. I don't know if you remember, but back at Mount Sinai, they attempted to worship Yahuwah on a man-made holiday, holy day. Aaron made the golden calf as a mediator between them and Yahuwah. And he said, tomorrow will be a festival to Yahuwah. So it's his own day that he created with his own image right there that he created. And if you remember when Moses came down and broke the covenant, symbolizing them breaking the covenant because of this idolatry, this idolatrous act. 3,000 people died that day. And it was actually at the hands of those who did not bow down to this golden calf and drink from the wine of that and celebrate on the pagan holiday, or the man-made holiday, I should say. So is that clear? We don't want to be celebrating a feast that Yahuwah said not to in the way that he said not to. We want to celebrate the biblical ones. So I hope that is clear. I want to move on here. So just to summarize again, Harry asked the question, can we just add the biblical feast into our Christian walk? No. And the reason is because these feasts are diabolically set against what is at the core and central to Christendom. And you would have to leave that in order to do this. They don't mix. It's like oil and water. All right, so moving on, stay tuned for the next video. This will be part number 5, where Harry asked me the question in his email, is God displeased with me because I am a Christian? Can you answer that question right now? So I have a little bit to say on that in the next video. I'll see you there. In the meantime, please subscribe to my channel if you like it. Isaac, my channel, Teshuvah Ministries. Yeah. And if you like this video, of course, click on like. Everybody says this, I know. I don't even know why we have to say this in the videos, but I am. So, and then also, if you want to learn about the biblical feast and you want to do that Teshuvah, please click on the biblical course link below. It'll take you to Kingdom University, and there you can sign up when it becomes available. And maybe you're watching this right now and it's still not available. It won't be available till December, somewhere around December 1st or throughout the month of December in 2020. But if it's after that, it should be there for you to register and join in to learning how to Teshuvah. All right, shalom. Have a wonderful day. Well, we're just gonna go with it like this, I think.